Welcome to the second session in our track here. And I'm very happy to introduce the next speaker to you. We've got a few more people coming in. Come on in, grab a seat. We've got plenty of seats at tables up front here. Up here on stage is Tommy Hamilton with Quicken Loans, and he's a platform architect. And in the time that I've spent at Docker, I've come to understand what a key role that is, and not just the team that is enabling the product, but in terms of the key person to make it work for the organization, and actually figure that out. So I'm sure Tom has a lot of good wisdom to share with you, and we're gonna let him take it from here. We'll leave some time for questions at the end. So take it away.
All right. How's it going? My name's Tommy Hamilton. I'm a platform architect with Quicken Loans. If you're not familiar with Quicken Loans, we're the nation's largest mortgage lender, and we've won 9 consecutive J.D. Power Awards for customer service, which is a lot of years in a row. So if you're looking for a new house, maybe you're looking for a refi or a purchase, definitely check us out. It's a great customer experience. In addition to that, if you like what you see here, if you have a passion for the technology that we're discussing and you're looking for opportunities, definitely reach out to myself, reach out to our careers team, check out our careers page so that we can see what kind of opportunities that we have for you. So the topic today is why making your containers run is only 40% of the solution. And for the subject, there's a million things that I could talk about, from day two operations, role-based access control, how to handle multiple clusters, CI/CD strategy, advanced networking stuff, software SDLC, et cetera. But obviously you don't wanna sit here and listen to me talk for the next 5 hours. So what I've done is I've narrowed it down to the two core components that I think are the most critical for your business to be focusing on today. Those two topics are container security and how you can future-proof your architecture. All right, let's get started. Container security. If we're going to talk about security, we first have to talk about where your app is running, where the code is running. And in this case, when we're using containers, that would be the container image. So the very first thing that you want to do, you're probably familiar with this, is you want to make sure that you start with a small footprint. Pretty big no-brainer there. The less stuff that there is in your image, the less stuff there is for someone to attack. A lot of this is baked into the cake when you're using containers. The whole idea is that you only include in your container what's absolutely necessary for your application to run. So, you know, a lot of this is kind of, like I said, baked into the cake. What you want to make sure that you're doing, however, is, you know, if you're adding things like build tools or something like that into your containers, remove those things at build time, again, so that you can remove as much attack surface as possible. Anytime that we start talking about container images, a debate comes up about whether to allow the developers to build their own containers or if you should go through the effort of maintaining a private repository of like golden company images, right? I can definitely see the use case for either one of these use cases or any either of these approaches. Personally, I like to lean towards removing as many roadblocks as possible between the developer having an idea and being able to execute on that idea as possible. So I lean more towards the autonomy approach. But if we take a look at what you're actually trying to accomplish by creating a golden repository, usually what it boils down to is like three things. Number one, you want to make sure that your containers are starting with a secure base. So, you know, they're not downloading some random container off the internet that has a rootkit. The second thing that you're trying to accomplish usually is that you want to enforce that packages that your company always wants included in your containers, like some, you know, standard company framework, is always included in every container. The third thing is usually the flip side of that, which is you have stuff that you don't want in the containers and you want to get rid of that. So what I want to talk about is how you can accomplish those strategic goals without restricting the options of the developer team members. So the first step to accomplishing this goal is to enforce a policy that your dev teams or all your containers are being built with official images only. Now the reason for this is because the official images are maintained by or are created by the vendor or the maintainer. So since that's the case, you probably should be able to have a reasonable level of expectation that there's not a rootkit baked into that company image. For the other stuff, and to enforce these policies, I would recommend implementing a strategy called linting. Now, if you're not familiar with linting, it works much the same way as static code analysis does. Just in this case, instead of looking at application code, we're going to be looking at the Docker file itself. And so, for example, for the policy where I want to have only official images, you'll notice that anything in Docker Hub, Nginx, for example, all the official repositories are root level. And anything that's custom, like if I were to put my own Nginx container on Docker Hub, it has a slash in it, right? Because it has to be nested under my personal repository. So what you could do is you would have in your CI/CD pipeline, when your container is being built, you have a step that looks at your Docker file and says, okay, look at the from line of my Docker file. Is there a slash in that line? And is it referencing my own private repository, or is it some random one on the internet? That's a very easy way that you could then enforce that policy that you have of official images only. Similarly, what you could do is you could look for the line that says, always add this company framework to the container. Or similarly, you could say, look for these things that we don't want to be included. And if we see those things, then fail the build or send something to the dev teams. Next, I want to talk about patching. For basically any company here, when a new security vulnerability comes out, your approach to patching or your approach to fixing that is one of two things. Either A, you install the patches for the security vulnerability, or B, you wait for the patches to become available so that you can patch the vulnerability. No one here is writing zero-day patches, probably. So if that's the case, and if patching is such like a critical part of what we do to protect our runtime environment, why is it that we struggle so much to stay on top of patches? From what I see, it kind of boils down to a few different things. Number one, patching takes time, right? Like, it's going to take some sort of effort. Maybe it's myself or yourself or some other team, but anyway, someone has to do that. Number two, probably more importantly, is that sometimes it takes downtime, right? Like maybe you're not in a containerized environment, so you have to like bring a server down and then that incurs some downtime. But the third thing, and probably the most impactful, is that like we're afraid that it's going to break prod, right? So my solution solves two of those issues and then helps mitigate the risk of the third one. So what I would recommend to you is to add update statements into each of your Docker files. If we take a look here, you'll see on line 2 and 3, we have an update statement for an Alpine container. Now what this is going to do is it's going to, at build time, install the latest patches for the operating system of the Alpine container, as well as any of the packages that you've already installed. Now what are the benefits of this? Number one, you get the latest patches. Good job. Number two is that it happens automatically at build time. So no one is doing this manually. If your containers are being built in your CI/CD pipeline, which they should be, then this just happens automatically for you. So since it's happening within the confines of your CI/CD pipeline, that means that it's also going through your automated testing. So if it's automatically being tested, then it means that as soon as new code is released, it's automatically getting the latest patches possible, it's automatically being tested, and so if something is going to break, it should be breaking in dev, not in production. The most important benefit is that it empowers you with choice. The choice of whether to take the time now to figure out why that patch is breaking your application, and then promote that image once you figure that out, or to just document that that's an issue and then come back to it sometime later. But the point is that after all of this has happened in your CI/CD pipeline, you should have a reasonable level of expectation that prod's not going to break. Next, let's talk about image scanning. So image scanning is pretty self-explanatory. You scan the images and it tells you what's inside of the container. Now, this technology is pretty powerful, but there's definitely some use cases that I would advise against. So for example, you could create a policy that says something like, if my running containers have more than 100 critical vulnerabilities, don't let it run. Now the problem with that approach is, when is your vulnerability dictionary being updated? It's being updated all throughout the day. And so what happens when yesterday your app had 99 critical vulnerabilities in production, and today, when the dictionary is updated, it has 100. That policy would stop your production containers from running. I don't know about you, but we think that security is important, but we think that prod being up is more important. The other issue that I see with this approach is that it seems like a completely arbitrary approach. You know, what makes 100 critical vulnerabilities terrible so we should shut prod down, but then 99 is like somehow okay? You know, that just doesn't make a lot of sense to me. So instead, the use cases that I would point you to, the ones that I find would be valuable, are these. Number one, to provide feedback to your devs, right? Maybe, you know, this application has 6-year-old Java, but maybe they inherited that application and they didn't even know that. You know, maybe they're just, you know, keeping the wheels turning on it and they didn't know that it had all these vulnerabilities. So the first thing is being able to provide visibility to let them know, hey, these are the packages that you have, these are the steps that you could take to fix it, and these are the issues that we see, right? With that visibility, what you could also do is in your CI/CD pipeline, you could create a security gate. So the security gate would look something like this. Your code is released, the container is automatically built, the container is pushed to your image repository, wherever your artifact repository is, and then an image scan is done. And there you say, okay, if I have more than 100 critical vulnerabilities, or better yet, if I have this specific CVE, right? Like this, if I have Heartbleed and my company never wants Heartbleed to be built and deployed, then identify that specific CVE in the list of the vulnerabilities that it finds, and then provide visibility to your dev team, say, hey, pretty bad thing. Or, you know, you could even fail the build. But the point is that what you're failing is the built container or the building container, not the running container. That's the point. On top of that, you know, again, visibility can be provided to your InfoSec team. Maybe you know, they're not aware of the security landscape of the 4,000 applications in your environment. It's probably that's the case. So this could give you an avenue to provide the InfoSec team with visibility, and then they can use it for whatever auditing purposes or whatever that they need. Next is to prevent your containers from running as root or admin. Now, this is an interesting one because by default, all of your containers run as root or admin. That's the default setting. Unfortunately, running as root or admin has been at least a contributing factor to almost every like major exploit breaking out of like, you know, the Docker jail that's happened. So, you know, if it's a default setting, but it could potentially be a security vulnerability, how do you know if you should be doing it or not? The good news is that if all of this is news to you, you don't. The use cases for running your containers as elevated, right, are pretty special. And if it's something that you needed to do, then you would know that you needed to do it. In order to fix this is very simple. This is what a Docker file in Linux would look like. So on line 6 and 7, we see on line 6, we're creating a user. Line 7, we simply say user is that user. Now this is going to run that container as that user. I click fast. Sorry, take pictures fast, I guess. All right, there we go. So this is what it looks like in Windows. Same thing, right? Line 16 is where we create our user. Line 17 is where we say user is, in this case, my user. That's it. Okay, least privilege principle. So the least privilege principle states that unless something explicitly needs access to something else, then it should not have access to that something else. So in other words, everything should only have the access that it needs to get its job done and nothing else. In the area of network security, the least privilege principle most often manifests itself in the form of network microsegmentation. So take, for example, the situation where you have three services, A, B, and C. Service A and B need to talk to one another. Service B and C need to talk to one another. But service A and C do not need to talk to one another. In a microsegmented network situation, A and C would not be able to talk to one another. So to accomplish this, you have a few options. Number one, you could implement a CNI like Calico, Tigera, like, you know, there's a bunch that are out there. Number two, you could set up a container-based firewall, commercial, open source, there's a lot of options. If you're really advanced, you could set up an Istio service mesh, and then you could have service mesh policies that say service A is able to do get puts, whatever, to service B, but not vice versa. You can do cool stuff with that. Or you could use the native overlay networking in Docker Enterprise Edition. So this is a compose file. If you're not familiar with the compose file, you can think of it like this. If the Docker file is the recipe for creating your container, then the compose file is the recipe for deploying your services. So this is a compose file, and if you take a look at the top section underneath services on line 3, I create my 3 services just by naming the services. So here I've named service A, B, and C. Now what I've done is at the bottom, lines 23 to 26, I've created 3 networks. I create them just by naming them, service A, B, and C. And then to set up my micro-segmentation, all I do is I go to each one of my services. So you'll see service A is joined to networks A and B. Service B is joined to A, B, and C. And service C is joined to B and C. So here, we're accomplishing network micro-segmentation. Next, let's talk about network encryption. So let's say that you have a publicly facing website, right? Maybe that website is taking PII, PIFI, personally identifiable information, personally identifiable financial information. From me, the client, to the container is going to be encrypted, right? I'm going to be hitting a load balancer. That load balancer is going to be SSL, HTTPS. So from me to the load balancer is definitely going to be encrypted. My SSN is secure. But what are you doing from your front end to your midware? What are you doing from your other midwares, or from that midware to the other midwares? How is your east-west traffic protected? Your options are either A, or I guess 1, you could do no encryption. So I guess see how that goes for you. Number 2 is that you could use load balancers in between each of your east-west services. So the way that it would work would be you'd have like service A. Service A would hit a load balancer, and then that would send the traffic to service B. Now, that would encrypt from service A to the load balancer, but then from the load balancer to service B would still be unencrypted. The way that you could get end-to-end encryption is you could use certificates. So you could add a certificate inside of the container for service B. And that certificate is for the load balancer that's sitting in between the services. And then you would get end-to-end encryption. But the problem with that is that now every single one of your apps has certificates. And if those certificates are rotated or expire or revoked, now all your prod services break. That's probably not a good situation. Or you could use encrypted overlay networks. And you could guess which one I think is the best option. So here's the same compose file that we had before where we were doing micro-segmentation. And you'll notice that at the bottom, I've made a little change. I've added 3 lines. And those 3 lines are driver overlay, driver options, encrypted true. I add these 3 lines to each one of my networks. And now each one of those networks are encrypted with mutual TLS. So here is an example where I set up 3 services that are micro-segmented with mutual TLS encryption, all in 35 lines. Which is pretty cool for 35 lines. Okay, runtime protection. In my opinion, runtime protection is the most consequential container security feature that's currently available. And instead of talking more and going through more slides, I thought that I'd do a demo to demonstrate some of the features that you can get from runtime protection. Now, before I get started, I want to make a disclaimer. The features that you're about to see are available in many products, both open source and commercial. I encourage you to go out and test all of them, do a POC, do the pro cons right, find the one that's right for your organization. It's just simply not practical, of course, for me to do a demo of every single tool up here. So I've chosen the tool that I have the most experience with. But again, I want to encourage you to go out and do your own research, find the tool that's the best for your organization. So the tool that we're going to be using is Aqua. We have a gentleman from Aqua right here. He's going to keep an eye on me, I guess. So what I've done is I've created a policy here that's called implicit deny, OK? And inside of this policy, I've set the scope here to container name is test service. So what this is going to do is it's going to say, don't apply this policy or only apply this policy to containers with the name test service. Now, right now, if we scroll to the bottom, we see that there are no containers right now. And the policy, as it were, is an allow everything policy. So not exactly what you would call super secure. So the first thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to start a container. So Docker run, and then I'm going to set the name to test service. And let's just make this Nginx. So now if I flip back into my policy, I see already that I have the container that is identified. So now let's hop in to that container and let's see what kind of network access we have. So I'm gonna exec into this container. Okie dokie. So now let's do an apt-get update. I'm hitting some stuff on the internet. Already we're looking pretty good. Let me install curl. Hitting some more stuff on the internet. Again, looking pretty good that we have open internet connectivity. But just for funsies, once this is done, let's just do a quick curl to google.com. Okay, so I get a response back. Pretty evident, we have internet access. But maybe my company's security posture isn't that everything has, you know, wide open access to the internet. What I can do is I can apply another policy. And maybe that policy is called implicit deny. So I'm gonna click that, click save, go back to my container, do the same thing, curl google.com, and just like that, it doesn't work. Now I don't know about you, but google.com is actually my favorite website. So I simply can't live without it. So what I'm gonna do is I'm going to layer on top of my implicit deny policy another policy that says allow google.com. Gonna click save again. Let me come over and kill this, curl google.com. And just like that, I'm able to hit google.com. But what I'm not able to do is to curl yahoo.com. And all is right in the world. So what we've just done is we've implemented a container-based firewall, set up an implicit deny policy, and then poked a holes to a single endpoint that we want to be able to reach. Now, the endpoint that I opened up was google.com, but in reality, this would be like, you know, an RDS instance, an API gateway, an ALB, something like that, right? But the important part is that just like that, we were able to apply that policy and also scope down that policy to only a specific container for a specific service. Now what we've done here, right, is I've ran apt-get and I've installed curl. But that just as easily could have been me downloading some random code off the internet that didn't go through source control, didn't go through our CI/CD pipeline. Could have also, worse yet, it could have been, you know, maybe I'm a bad actor and I'm downloading my toolkit and now I'm running, you know, random executables inside this container. So what you can also do with runtime policies is we can come down here to this runtime policy. And we can check this little box that says preventing running executables not in the original image. Click save. And then come here, curl google.com. Just like that, the curl that I just installed like 5 minutes ago is not able to run. There's a lot more that you could do with these types of tools. You could set up, for example, auditing to tell you when containers are running as root or admin. You could tie this in with the security gates that we were mentioning before. You could set up SecCom policies, which will let you say which applications are able to make which system calls. Again, I want to stress that you know, these types of features are available in a lot of different products, open source and commercial, and you should definitely go and check them out. What I wanted to do is highlight that if you're not already looking at this type of functionality, you should be. Okie dokie. Let's get back into it. This is the video that I was going to play in case that demo bombed. Okay, so next let's talk about how to future-proof your architecture. Now in this section, I'm going to attempt to convince you of my position that one data center or one cloud is no longer enough for your organization. So why should you care about multi-cloud? The reason that you should care about multi-cloud is that if you're not already planning for it now, you are putting your company at a competitive disadvantage to other companies that are. A lot of the times we say things like we want to use the best tool for the job, right? But the reality is that the best tool for the job is not always going to be inside of your data center or your preferred cloud vendor. Let's say, for example, that your team wants to use the best of breed serverless technology. Well, today that would probably be AWS Lambdas. Let's say that you're a Windows shop and you have heavy reliance on Microsoft products. Maybe you do a lot with SSIS, SSRS. Right now, the best of breed for those technologies would be Microsoft Azure. Maybe a different part of your business wants to do big data, search, machine learning. Right now, arguably, the leaders in that sector would be GCP. So as we've just demonstrated very easily, the statement that we want to use the best tool for the job and we're going to use one data center, one cloud, are mutually exclusive. A lot of the time when we start talking about multi-cloud, we get stuck in an argument about vendor lock-in, right? One side says, you know, it's scary, we might want to break up with them later. I don't want to paint ourselves into a corner. And then the other side says, hey, you know, we got to put up or shut up, it's time to go all in. Instead of looking at it like that, I like to think of it, instead of vendor lock-in, I like to think about vendor enablement. What I mean by that is that your goal should be to enable your team and your company to leverage the tools of all the other vendors. Right now, we have a situation where, you know, AWS is the best in Lambda, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But that landscape is changing, and it's going to change in the future. And so if we want to be able to now and in the future enable our team to use the best of breed technology, it's mandatory that we start thinking about multi-cloud infrastructure. We see further evidence that this is the way that the industry is moving from the public cloud vendors themselves. So I don't think that it's any news, but the top three cloud vendors are AWS, Azure, and GCP. Within the last year, we've seen each of those three vendors release their own multi-cloud and hybrid cloud offerings. So recently, AWS announced AWS Outposts, which has the promise of taking some of AWS and putting it in your data center, the vision being that you'll put a lot more in a lot of different places. Azure Stack is basically the same idea, and that's from Microsoft, of course. And recently at the Google Next conference, Google announced Google Anthos, which is the promise of taking Google Kubernetes Engine from Google Cloud Platform and having it run inside of your data center as well as the other public cloud providers. So if the top three public cloud vendors are each making, you know, multi-cloud and hybrid cloud core business offerings that they're focusing on, you know, it's a pretty good indicator that there's some demand out there. And if the demand is not coming from you, then it probably means it's coming from your competitors. Okay, so let's talk about hybrid cloud. Digital transformation is a topic that's been getting a lot of play in the last 3 years. The problem is, as we start digging deeper into what digital transformation actually means, it usually ends up meaning a bunch of code refactor and system redesign. Now, maybe this form of digital transformation is tenable if you are a small or a younger company, right? Like, you don't have that much stuff, so it's not that big of a deal for you to refactor that stuff. The problem is, that I see, is that if you are a more established company or a much larger company, that form of digital transformation simply doesn't scale. A lot of the times when we talk to the cloud vendors, the solution that we're given to use their services is to lift and shift. So take the stuff that you have on-prem, where possible, pick it up, move it into the cloud. But what do you do when you have 20 years worth of technology debt, or you have a 25-year-old technology stack that you've been building? You have 4,000 applications that are very tightly intermingled. Maybe some of them freak out if the latency between them is too much. Maybe some of the services are sending an untenable amount of data across the wire, right? How do you move those 4,000 applications? You just can't. Now, some of you might be thinking, well, you know, solution is easy, refactor. I read 12-factor app, just do it, right? But what's the value proposition of that? You know, what do you get? You know, so let's say that you have 4,000 apps, right? And you're going to take several hundred developers, like 90% of their time for 1, 2, maybe 3 years, and at the end of it, what did you do? You digitally transformed your apps, and you can sit on this stage and you can talk all about it, but what you didn't do is get any new business features out to your clients for that period of time. It just doesn't make sense. Instead of a binary choice between refactoring your old systems for no value added or abandoning those systems for the promises of all the great things that you get in the public cloud, hybrid cloud allows you to get both of those situations. And What I like to think of it as is instead of digital transformation, I like to think of digital retrofitting, okay? So instead of fundamentally changing our old apps, we take our old apps and we bolt on brand new technology that enables the functionality that you're hoping to get by refactoring, just without refactoring. For example, let's say that you have like a legacy web application. Pick that up and put it into a container. Now that it's in a container, it's on a modern platform. Now that it's in a container, it's portable. Maybe you need service discovery, and that's something that you didn't have before. Because you're in a container now, you can put that service behind whatever, you know, layer 7 load balance or whatever you want, and now you have service discovery. Maybe your app is so old that it doesn't even support like SSL or HTTPS, and you need to bring up the security. Well, like we just saw, we're able to take our services and implement microsegmentation and network encryption, but we didn't change a single thing on the app side. Maybe your 4,000 apps don't have retry logic, and you want to have retry logic. Well, instead of refactoring 4,000 apps to have retry logic, because you're in a container, now you could take advantage of an Istio service mesh. And in that service mesh, you could set up a service mesh policy that will do retry logic for all your 4,000 applications. Same thing could be done with circuit breaking. Maybe you need more visibility on what these apps are doing. You don't have the telemetry data that you want. Same thing. Because the service mesh is getting those metrics, you can capture those metrics and send them to whatever time series database that you want and visualize them with whatever open source, you know, Kali, whatever tool you want, right? But the point is that with digital retrofitting, you leave your legacy application alone and you get the new features that you were hoping for, okay? So what are the arguments against hybrid cloud and multi-cloud? Any takers? The answer is that it's hard. That's basically it. But what I want to do now is to challenge that perception by demonstrating how you can get the infrastructure architecture that you want as long as you use the tools and the strategy, the right tools and the strategy to accomplish your goals. So this is going to get us into our next demo. Now, another disclaimer, I want you to know that the app that you are about to see is not my app. It was created by these folks, at least in part. I pulled it from a public GitHub repo. It's on like Docker's main GitHub. You could get it here. So I'll give like 5 seconds to take a picture. OK, nobody cares about that. That's cool. Again, I want to stress that this is not my app. I didn't create this app. I didn't contribute to this app. So please yield any and all credit back to those people that I mentioned before. So this is what the app looks like. It's a 5-component app. It's a voting app. There's 2 front ends. One's Python, one's Node.js. It has Redis, Postgres, and also it has a .NET Core 2.0 worker. So I'm going to now deploy that service into a Docker Enterprise cluster that I have. So here's my cluster, ta-da. We got some UCP, some DTR going on. If we take a look at the stacks, you'll see I don't have anything, right? Nothing up my sleeves. There's no stack that's running here. So the thing that I'm going to use to deploy my service, my services is the compose file again. So, you know, again, compose declarative to make 5 services, name 5 services, pretty simple. And then the method that I'm going to use for deployment is the UCP client bundle. So this is happening through command line. So the command that I'm going to do first is docker stack deploy -c, and then I'm going to put it at this, call it Tommy test stack. So far, so good. OK, so it's going to create a network for my service to live on, and then it's going to create 3 of my backing services. So now if I come back into here, OK, so 2 of them are already green. Let's check the worker. Should be starting up anytime. OK, great. So far, so good. OK, so next I'm going to do docker stack deploy, and then I'm going to point it at my other compose file. Again, it's going to create a custom network for my stuff to sit on, and then it's going to deploy my 2 services. These are my 2 front ends. So now if I flip back into here, thank the demo gods, everything is green. OK, that's cool. So now let's hit the service. So I come here. I got 1 front end. I got another front end. And let's see if I can make a vote. Okie dokie. So make the vote. 100% of people like cats. Now dogs. It looks like someone else is voting. Can you stop that, please? But yeah, so here we see that our voting app is working. It's working all right for us. You can see down here it's capturing that there are two votes because my colleague is in the front of the room. And if we look down here at the bottom, you'll notice where it says process by container ID, right? And so if I click back and forth and keep making votes, process by container ID isn't changing. Now the reason why that's happening is if we come back here and we look at vote, I only have one service right now, or I only have one container that's running for the service. And right now it's running on a box that's called AWS Worker 1. So, is this just good luck that, I actually have two workers, one's called AWS Worker, one's called GCP Worker. So is it just good luck that it landed on that one? No, what I'm doing is in the service, I have a placement constraint that says node.labels.cloud equals AWS. And you could probably guess that on my AWS worker, I gave it this label right here of cloud. Cloud is AWS. So when the platform goes to schedule the service, it only puts it on the box that has the label of cloud equals AWS. Now what I've also done is I've added another key that's called platform equals multi-cloud. And I've also added that to my GCP worker. And just because. I could be lying. You don't know me. I'm not lying. But here's my GCP worker. It's 10.142.15.209. Here's GCP 10.142.15.209. So definitely in GCP. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come here to my compose file. I'm going to bump this up to two replicas, and I'm going to modify my placement constraints to remove the restraint of cloud equals AWS, and to implement platform equals multi-cloud. I'm going to do this on both of my front-end services. This is where I'm just building the suspense, just going through here. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to come back here, and I'm just going to run the exact same thing. And that's going to go out to my platform, and it's going to bump my instances up to two, and then hopefully do something pretty cool. Okay. So let me come here, services, ta-da, we see that there are two running now. And if we take a look at vote and we look at the containers, you see that one is on AWS Worker 1, the other one is on GCP Worker 1. Now, the reason why they're equally distributed is because of this setting. I have on top of a placement constraint which says don't put my container on anything that doesn't meet this label, I have a placement preference, which says to spread equally between cloud AWS and cloud GCP. So now if I flip back to my page and I do my vote, my service is still working. That's pretty cool. But a weird thing is happening. At the bottom, even though I'm voting back and forth, the container ID isn't changing. The reason that that's happening is because I'm hitting this from the West Coast. My GCP infrastructure is set up on the East Coast. So here I have a box aptly named East Coast Client. And if I pull this up, the exact same URLs make this happen. So you can still see that this app is reacting in near real time. However, if you'll notice at the bottom, process by container ID is a different container than what was running in the West Coast. So this one is E6D, and the other one is 0414. So what we did is we were able to deploy the service not only in multiple clouds, but in multiple geographic regions, and then do latency routing to those different services. So pretty cool. This is the other video that I was going to play in case my demo bombed. All right, now let's talk about what we did. We created a cluster, and we deployed a fairly complex app to two different public cloud vendors in two different geographic regions. We tied those two regions together with AWS Route 53, which is using region-aware latency-based load balancing. Not only that, but all the services that we just deployed are on micro-segmented networks, and all the traffic that's sent between them is being encrypted with mutual TLS. we were able to create one of the most desirable infrastructure architectures in the world, and it all happened in about 5 minutes. But what's most impressive to me is what we didn't do. We didn't change a single line of application code. We didn't change a single connection string in our app or require that a single connection string be changed for any of our upstream dependencies. And yet, we were able to greatly increase the capabilities, resiliency, and security of our application with just a few lines in a config file, and that's the point. My name is Tommy Hamilton. I want to thank you for taking the time to sit down and listen to me speak. I hope it's given you something to think about and helped you to understand why I believe that making your containers run is only 40% of the solution. Thank you.
Thank you, Tommy. And I'm just guessing that there might be one or two questions for you here in the audience. If anyone has one, raise your hand.
Do you have any suggestion for blue-green or canary deployments?
Sure. So the question was, do I have any suggestions for blue-green or canary deployments? So first, it's important to delineate the difference between blue-green and canary. Blue-green is I have 100% of my blue app running, now I have 100% of my green app running, and 0% of my blue app running. Canary deployments is I have both running, I'm sending 90% to blue, 10% to green, and then I can traffic shape to flip that paradigm. If the question is, how do I do that in like Kubernetes, it's pretty easy. With Kubernetes, there's tools that are already built because with Kubernetes, you have pods and pods can have multiple containers. It's fairly simple to say, okay, like just deploy two of my app containers to this pod and then just send like 10% of the traffic to the new one and then change that. If the question is, how do you do canary deployments with Swarm, where with Swarm you can only have one service tied to one image, it's a little bit more complicated. The way that you could do that, theoretically, is let's say that you were having your services reached by custom service ports, right? What you would do is you would have two stacks. You would have one that is on like port 20,000, the other one's on port 20,001. You tie both of those to two load balancers, then you use Route 53 or some other global DNS traffic shaper to say to wait which load balancer it's going to go to, and then you empower the dev teams to handle that. That'll get what you want.
Okay. Anyone else?
I talk really fast. Did that make sense? Okay. Catch me afterwards if you have questions.
Okay. Going once. All right. Thanks for coming. Our next session begins at 3:00 in this room if you're staying with the track. So stand by. We'll be right back.